Okay, we are in session 4 today, and this is completely on .NET memory management. In this session we will look into the .NET memory management overview and the internals of garbage collection, and we'll deep dive into the garbage collection and look into see what all we need to know in terms of the garbage collector. So this is one of the most interesting topic all the time, and also the most important and interesting topic altogether. So garbage collection is the best image I can find to demonstrate in the real-time world is the garbage collector. So similarly, this is a concept that we're going to relate to the programming, especially with the .NET. Especially in general. In other words, in today's session we're going to see garbage collection as a general topic and then relate that to the how it is implemented in .NET. So this is what the garbage collection is all about, and its definition and its little bit of history behind it. And normally in computer science, especially since we, if you relate to the image, it's not a computer science, it's normally a waste management in real world. But in computer science, garbage collection is a form of automatic memory management. So it is a special case of resource management in which the limited resource being managed is memory. So we know what is a memory, we don't have to elaborate on that. And the garbage collector or just collector attempts to reclaim garbage or memory occupied by objects that are no longer in use by the program. And garbage collection was invented by John McCarthy around 59 to solve the problems in Lisp. So Lisp is again one of the oldest programming languages. It's the second oldest high-level programming language after Fortran. And Lisp is a functional programming language that emphasizes on applications of functions. And in the recent time, again, a function-based programming has been, again, very hot, for which we have F-sharp. F-sharp.net is a function-based, essentially a functional programming language. If you're interested, you can actually take a look at it. It's very much useful for scientific-based applications whereon you have a complex algorithms that need to be evaluated, for which F-sharp is one of the most good language. And if you trace back, Lisp is the first high-level programming language which started using the garbage collection, and the man behind that is McCarthy. And McCarthy, if you're following the news recently, he just passed away recently, just on October 23rd. 2011, and he's the man behind the keyword called artificial intelligence as well. So he's the man who brought the terminology into the industry also. So he's one of the geniuses that we have lost recently. So that's a quick overview of what is a garbage collection. So we'll move on with the terminology behind the garbage collection. So the, as we'll see, this is the object reference graph. We see three colored objects in the reference graph. Again, the colors may not be again specific to the object graph, but in general, just to identify the terminology, I'm just making use of the best colors possible. And the first color is the black. So the first is called the root objects. The root objects are the objects from where the references to the other objects start. So that's the root object. These objects are the candidates for entry point for garbage collection and can never go unreachable. So those are the two important things that we need to keep in mind. So whenever GC kicks off, it actually starts from the root objects. And there's another term called the root set, refers to the collection of root objects. So root objects can be n number of root objects. Wherever you have a parent-child relationship, and the parent object, when you instantiate it, that becomes a root object, and that's when it becomes a one of the items inside the root set. So in general, GC, whenever it kicks off, it's going to look up into the root set and iterate into the all the root objects, and then starts its search. And it starts searching for what? Start looking for the reachable objects inside your object tree. So objects in blue in this diagram or in this graph refers to the reachable objects, or in other words called as an active references, also refers to as a strong references, and the arrow shows the references between them. So if you take a couple of scenarios within the arrows that are showed in this diagram, in this graph, one is a linear reference wherein one object is referring to another object. It's a one-to-one reference, and of course in the second case it's also referring to another object, so it has a one-to-many references here. And if you take a look at the object 4, it's actually referring to itself, so it's a self-reference again. And if you take a look at the object 5 in this graph and object 3, so they are actually referring to each other. So that means it's actually object 3 is referring to object 5, and also object 5 is referring to object 3. So this is called a cyclic reference. And of course the other one has a completely linear 1-to-1. Object 2 is actually having only 1-to-1 reference, but object 4 is actually referring to itself. And finally, object 6, which is in red. So this becomes the object in red is a unreachable object, or in other words called as an out of scope reference, or also termed as a weak reference. Why it is weak reference? Just a second, it's kind of some interruption here. Okay, good. Okay. Looks like there's some slight disturbance from these otherwise. Okay, don't worry. Back here. So the red object is called an unreachable object or a weak reference, and the red objects are the one which will be the target for reclaiming for garbage collection. And another key thing here is although object 6 is referring to object 5 in this graph, it doesn't really mean that it is out of, it is still having some reference. So what this graph indicates is whenever, as we see, the GC starts from the root objects, and the references need to be traced all the way back from the root object. So if you traverse from the root object, you will see that the object 6 is not reached. So that means although object 6 is referring to something else, this becomes a candidate for claiming the memory. Okay. That's being said, we will move on to the various algorithms available or in use with the garbage collection in the industry. This is spread across the various programming languages, not specific to .NET in general. So we'll have a glimpse of various algorithms. The first one I have. Again, I haven't listed all the algorithms available, but these are some of them. So the tricolor marking is one of the algorithm wherein it traverses through the object tree and marks with three different colors, the white, gray, and black in general. Each of these colors have their own representation. So white being said, it is ready for reclaim. These are the ideal candidates for claiming the memory. And the gray are the ones which are going to likely to stay. This is just a color representation with respect to the tricolor marking. There's nothing to do with the object graph that I have just shown. Okay, and the black are the ones which are likely to be reclaimed, but not sure. Because they might be dependent on the objects in the white, which might have a references to this. So there are like a dependencies between the objects that are marked for reclaiming and also the objects that are in use by the objects that are marked for reclaim. And gray are the ones going to likely to stay. In other words, they're strong references. That's how the tricolor marking algorithm goes on. And the other one is the mark and sweep collection. Mark and sweep is, again, a most generic one, one of the most basic algorithm, wherein the first iteration will iterate through all the objects and mark that they are reachable. And the sweep comes and reclaims all the memory that are that are not reachable by the MARC algorithms. So that's how the MARC and sweep algorithm collection works. And the MARC and don't sweep algorithm, so this is going to just do a MARC, and but when the sweep will never kick off, resulting in the collection is not reclaimed. So these are various algorithms can tailor together to work more efficiently. So it can do the sweeping at a later stage whenever things get prioritized, just in case of incremental garbage collection. That's when the MARC is kicked off first in the sweep and then compact, so on. Copying garbage collection is one of the algorithm again, wherein the memory for the garbage collection is actually partitioned into two, keeping one as the main active memory block and another one is the inactive memory block. And whenever the need for garbage collection requirement arises, the garbage collection algorithm is going to make a copy of the main memory to the secondary heap, wherein it's going to copy only the objects that have been reached and leaving the unreached references in the main, in the primary one, and all the program will point back to the secondary heap and vice versa. So whenever the garbage collection kicks off, it's going to actually copy the secondary to primary and primary to secondary, and that's how the temporary partition of the memory storage is going to be made use. This has a high impact because in the first place itself, we're going to break the whole memory into two, which itself is very expensive because you are not optimally using the memory. But in certain cases, it's going to be useful. But again, so this is one of the algorithms that's available, and it's been used by various other means. And MARC sweep compact garbage collection is one of the most common, and also in .NET especially, this is the algorithm that's been used. MARC is the one. We're going to walk through the internal algorithms again. So MARC, or how the algorithm looks like, what the sweep does, and finally what is the compact. We're going to walk through each one of them in detail. And generational garbage collection is again in use with .NET. We'll see in detail what is this. And stop the world garbage collection, this is a kind of a side effect when we do the MARC sweep compact garbage collection, wherein it's going to stop the whole application till the memory reclaim is done. So that's the stop the world garbage collection. And incremental garbage collection is another algorithm wherein it's a kind of a tailored algorithms to MARC sweep and compact, wherein the at one increment the MARC is going to be done and it will not sweep. In other words, it's a MARC and don't sweep. And another iteration or another incremental collection cycle is going to do a sweep, and in another iteration is going to do a compact. So it's going to take a long time to implement the MARC sweep and compact algorithms in case of an incremental garbage collection. Now, why it does this way, we're going to see in detail. So this is just a list of the algorithms that are available, and just giving you a little bit high level overview. And the last and the most powerful is the concurrent garbage collection, which is available in .NET Framework 4.0. A concurrent garbage collection does the garbage collection behind the scene as a thread, and this is one of the most highly robust garbage collection available today. We'll see comparing each of these in detail, especially we'll concentrate more on the MARC sweep and compact in the following slides. And FYI, since the garbage collection is one of the most fundamental topic and also it's most complicated to demonstrate, although there are tools which we can make use of like the GC viewer and a couple of other like procmon and which we can use and monitor, and also the memory profilers we can use to demonstrate how it is actually doing, how when it's getting kicked off, things like that. But in this session, I'm not actually taking care of that. So keeping that in mind, this is going to be mostly theory, and of course we will be touch base with various common terminologies that have been used with, in context with the garbage collection. So mark and sweep, these are three step process wherein the garbage collection happens, and that's what most commonly works in the .NET. What does a mark do? The mark algorithm, whenever it kicks off, it's going to traverse the entire memory graph, as we show in the second slide, starting from the root and mark objects that are visited. So as we have seen, so it's going to just traverse through it. Wherever the reference is found, it's going to traverse through that object, and it's going to set that object as with a bit called a mark. It's going to mark it as it's visited. And soon after the mark is done, the sweep can be kicked off. Whenever the sweep kicks off, it's again a separate algorithm altogether, wherein it removes all the objects that are not visited. That's a key thing to know, because you're going to keep all the objects that are visited because they are having a strong reference, whereas the whichever is not visited, it's going to sweep. That means it's going to reclaim their memory. So it starts scanning objects from the first address in the heap. In other words, sweep is not going to start from the root set, whereas a mark starts from the root set. The sweep is actually going to start from the first address in the heap. And what is a heap? Again, we'll see more of the memory side when we start covering the .NET data types in subsequent sessions. If a mark flag is not set, that means it's going to reclaim. So that's the logic. It's simple logic. And if a mark flag is set, it's going to clear the flag. So that's what the two cases is going to handle. Why it's going to clear the flag? Because whenever the next cycle happens, the mark need to set the respective flag back to reached. That's when the algorithm can be successful. Whenever the sweep comes in, it's going to recognize only the objects that have been set. So that's the reason it's going to clear off the flag if the mark flag is set to true. And finally, the compact going to kick off. What does the compact mean? So it's going to actually compact is a, we're going to see again in detail one step down in the next couple of slides. In general, compact is going to defragment the fragmented memory caused by the sweep. So sweep, whenever it cleans up, it's going to leave some of the memory areas fragmented, and the compact is going to come in and make it compact. In other words, it's going to defragment the memory. So this will boost subsequent memory I/O. So we'll see more in detail. And as we have just seen that high level, as the types of references we have, one of the references is a strong reference. And what is a strong reference? The garbage collector can reclaim only objects that have no references. That we have just walked through that. An object that is reachable is said to have a strong reference. In other words, in the object reference graph, the blues are the one which are strong reference. And which cannot, these cannot be reclaimed by the garbage collector. And the weak references are the one which are not reachable from the root set or the object root object. The object is eligible for garbage collection. So these are, in other words, termed as the targets for reclaiming memory. And a given object can have a multiple weak references. This is an interesting topic to, again, elaborate. So if an object is not reached, how can they have a multiple weak, other weak references? It can have, so we'll see how. The primary advantage of maintaining weak references to an object is that it allows the garbage collector to collect or reclaim memory of the object if it runs out of memory and managed heap. So again, so it's a basic fundamental thing that whenever you want to maintain a weak reference, you just want to identify which are the ones you want to reclaim whenever the need arises. And there are two types of weak references. Number one is the short. The short weak references are the one which are ready to reclaim and becomes null when the object is reclaimed by the garbage collection. So they are done. So their life cycle is done soon after the garbage collection kicks off and GC kicks off and they get reclaimed, the memory is gone and they are no more reclaimable or no more reachable. But this long weak reference are the one which has a finalizer implementation. What this means is the long, whichever object has a finalizer implementation, it takes 2 GC runs for them to be reclaimed by the garbage collector. And that means it's going to have a long life in the heap. So that's when this is called a long weak reference. And is it possible that once, since you know the object is again out of reach, but still it's there in the memory. So is it possible for you to refer or regain a strong reference to the ones that have a weak reference? Certainly yes, you can. You can do that using the weak reference class. Weak reference itself is one of the class and that you can make use of it. I'm going to quickly jump into the solution side and I'm not going to do any demo on that, but I'm going to walk you through the classes that are available. And again, as we know, Object Browser is the one that you can make use of it. And before I make use of the that one, I'm going to open the project that we have been working on. So this is the same thing that we have been using. And let me look into my Object Browser to see if I can find. So there you go. So this is the class that you can actually make use of it. So this indicates weak reference is a class of inside the system namespace, and it represents the weak reference which references an object while still allowing the object to be reclaimed by the garbage collector. So this is an interesting thing. So if at all your object is out of reach and it's only marked as a weak reference, it's still available to it's available for reclaiming by the garbage collector. At the same time, you can still have a reference to that object and again regain a strong reference to it so that garbage collector will not pick it up down the line. So this is possible. So that's called a long reference and short reference. Of course, although it is possible, it's not guaranteed, because remember it's already marked for garbage collection, and if at all the GC kicks off before you gain a strong reference, then you will lose it definitely. So GC will go in its own algorithm, and wherever the it finds the marked bit, it's going to reclaim it. So before the GC kicks off, you have a chance wherein you can make use of the weak reference class and reclaim its or add a strong reference to it. And again, why will you need it, and when will you need it? That's again a fundamental question. Cases where you have an object and you might have an object in memory retention policy wherein you want to reclaim that kind of objects at a given interval. A typical example could be a large data set that you want to bring in and keep it in your cache or in a memory, which takes a considerable amount of I/O process or a database processing cycle, which takes to create that kind of a collection or an object or a data element inside your memory. And such things you might do as part of the application initialization process, wherein you load it completely, do all the necessary processing and load it into the memory. So it might take a considerable amount of I/O process. In that case, and later stage of the application becomes an idle stage, and you finally decided that this may not be required and you dispose it off. And later when the application becomes active again and you need that again, so in that case, so what you will do is you have to redo the whole initialization process. So to eliminate that, one best chance is to take a look at the object that has been created in the first place and see if it can be referred again. And if you succeed in referring it again and reusing it and creating a strong reference to that object, it's the straightforward and fastest way to get it back instead of doing the whole initialization process again. So in case if you fail to get the reference or to the object, in that case, of course, there's no other way. You have to redo the whole initialization process again. So in those cases, in those such scenarios, you can actually make use of the weak references classes and try to reclaim them whenever required. So that's a key note there. And of course, what's the percentage of scenarios you will come across that? There may be less than 1%. Okay, so it's good to know. And this another important element with respect to GC is the mark bit. A mark bit is part of an object header itself. So every object that we are creating, in other words, if I take you back to the code example and take you to the math class that we have created earlier, and where are we creating the instance of this? We are actually creating an instance of this math inside our button click. So this is the M is the object that we are creating instance of it. This is when the math class is actually instantiated in the memory. And whenever we make a call, once you make instance of it, you're going to make use of it, right? So whenever we create an instance of it, the object that is M in this case will have a header which you can't see normally. So if I run this code, take a little time, but okay. If you run this code and go to the next step by F10 and see it in the quick reference. So what all I can see here, I can see that's the math. M is a variable of type math class, but using your IntelliSense or the .NET Reflection, there is certain amount of memory that the M get occupies in the memory in the heap, which you can't gain access to. So which is strictly used only by the runtime. And one of that is the object header. So each of these variables will have an object header and a body. And how does that look like? So although I can't show it at runtime, but I can show you this way. So each of like an M in the example that we have seen, it has an actual data, in which case we have three functions. That's the data of that object. And it has a header which is not accessible or visible through the user code. This is the header information will be accessible only by the runtime, which is the respective CLR components, in this case GC. So inside the header, so this is the header is a 32-bit in the compact framework, and it could be 64-bit in the normal 64-bit programs. And so this is the amount of information, amount of memory that's allocated for the header. And inside the header, one of the attribute here is a mark bit. And this is the mark bit will be used for garbage collection. So the mark algorithm that we have just seen prior will make use of this attribute inside the header of the respective object to mark it as available or not. This is the one bit of information that is can take only 0 or 1. So 0 stands for off and 1 stands for on. That means whenever it's set to reached, it's going to be 1. And we'll see mark and sweep in action. So the first case, this is the ideal scenario wherein the memory state in the heap looks like, wherein we have a black object, so the blue objects here, and the root objects, the black ones, have a reference to the couple of objects. I should have actually made the other objects red, which indicates that those are the objects marked for reclaiming. So in other words, so this is the one that is red, and this is the one that is red. That means these two are the objects that are not reached if you take a look at from the visually. And this is the root object, and the, from the root object, the first object is reachable, and this object is actually making reference to the another object, which is the third in the row, and symbol again coming back to the root is actually referring to one of the other objects. So what is not reachable here is the this one. This is in red and this is in red. So these are the two objects that that are not marked as a reached one. So that's the first step when the mark is going to run. So that's how it looks like. So for the whenever the mark algorithm runs, this is how the output looks like, and these are the two objects in red. Okay, I'm just trying to put red there since I missed it in the first place. And so these are the objects that are marked that are there visited. And what happens when the sweep runs? When the sweep runs, as you see, all the reds are gone. That means all the unreached objects are gone. And it's actually, in this case, in other words, we can call this as a mark, sweep, and compact. All the three parts have been executed. That's why we see the objects in the second place are actually moved. In other words, if you take a look at the address, a memory address, this is a 0, is the first memory address, and this is a 1, 2, 3, and 4. So these are the address in the memory, and when the sweep comes into play, it's actually going to look like 0, 2, and 0, 2, and 3 are available, whereas 1 and 4 are not reachable. So the 1 and 4 are deleted from the memory. And you'll see that 0, 2, and 3 objects have been there. But when the compact going to run, it's going to rearrange them by doing this. What happens is 0, 1, and 2. So in other words, what I'm trying to bring here is the object in address 1 is no more the object that was earlier, because once the compact is run, it's going to rearrange or reshuffle all the addresses to keep it in a order, so that the consequent I/O operation is going to be much faster. So this is called the compaction, otherwise called defragmentation. So in the earlier case, you'll see the defragmentation because of the empty spaces after reclaiming those, and which will be compacted, and defragmentation takes place. Then that's how the memory is going to look like this. So there are no black holes in between the objects, and that's what the point here is. So in step 3 process, we have run the mark, sweep, and compact. So this, step 3 is going to, this is the mark, how it's going to look like, and after the sweep and compact runs, this is how the memory is going to look like. Okay. And when will the GC comes into play? So there are wide variety of reasons and scenarios when this can happen, and this is again specific to the respective programming language and the program and the hardware device that we're using, and also type of GC that you're going to be running. In general, the most common scenarios when the GC can kicks off is when the system is low in memory. When the system goes low in memory, it's guaranteed that GC is going to kick off. And also, if the memory is too fragmented, okay. In the second case, the memory is too fragmented. Okay, and when the memory is low, it's definitely going to kick off. And after a quanta of allocation, you can also specify a couple of systems can be configured to kick off GC soon after the percentage of the memory allocation has been reached, and that's when it can be kicked off. Especially, this is going to be more useful with the smart client devices like a tablet PCs or the smartphones and other things where the memory is very, very expensive. That's when especially with the .NET compact editions, this is going to be more effective. And when the memory allocation fails, that's the worst case scenario when GC will definitely kicks off. And the memory allocation can fail because of the unavailability of the memory. Say for example, you have a 10 KB of memory available and you're trying to create an object of size 11 KB, and definitely the allocation will fail, and that's when the GC kicks off to reclaim memory wherever possible to continue the execution of the application. And the threads are, again, another FYI, is the threads in the GC are executed by the operating system, not the CLR. So CLR in this case is just a manager. In other words, we know it's a runtime for .NET program, and we did walk through it in detail in the previous sessions. And the CLR is going to just invoke the GC whenever it's required, and GC is the one that's going to kick off as a process or as a thread inside the CLR to make sure that it's going to be cleared. But ideally speaking, at the bottom line, the operating system is the one who is going to managing the threads. So it's going to be running under the OS role. And however, GC kickoff scenario varies from respect to CLR. So we have a wide variety of CLRs, and we will see the list of a couple of them in the session today down the line. And but it is definitely far when allocation fails due to less available memory. So these are the scenarios wherein the GC will definitely guarantee to kick off, but there are a wide variety of other reasons or other scenarios which are widely different from CLR to CLR, your device or the programming language that we are using. So it's all open. And another important aspect here is the how GC kicks off. At a high level, if you take a look at the algorithm, how it works, the first step here is the get to a safe point. What this get to a safe point does is stop all threads. Okay, and we'll see how this stop all threads really work in the next slide. And soon after this action is taken, immediately it's going to get the roots. As we've seen, this is a root set that's going to be returned. So it's a collection of roots. That means a collection of the root objects. And it's going to iterate or traverse through all the objects inside the collection. This is just a for loop. And call the mark algorithm. So the mark is going to, this is a mark algorithm in other words. And the mark is going to actually mark whichever is visited in this iteration to set to true. That means the mark bit is set to true or set to 1. And soon after that, you're going to make the call of this sweep algorithm wherein whichever is not marked by the mark algorithm is going to be reclaimed, and whichever is marked, it's going to set the mark bit to false. And finally, the plan compaction is going to kick off. And why plan? So the plan compaction is going to kick off and determines the end result of the plan compact is going to say that whether you need to run the compact or not. And why do you need to do that? Because compaction is the most expensive task among all these, wherein, as we see in the previous slide, it tries to actually move the objects from one address to another address to fill the gaps in the address allocations. So that's called the defragmentation process. To do that, you have to actually bring the whole application to halt, which is called the stop the world GC. So again, so this is the general look of an algorithm, how the GC looks like, and based on the tailoring, how you do, when you're going to run the mark, when you're going to run the sweep, and when you're going to run the compact. Example is an incremental GC. It's going to be ran in a different instances altogether, so in a different time span altogether. So wherein the first mark algorithm is going to run at one phase and the sweep is going to run at a different phase. So need not be in a sequential order. So it depends upon how you tailor with respect to GC and how it is optimized to do it. Especially the compact plan or compact is going to determine whether you really need the compact to run or not. And if it is required, then the compaction is going to kick off. That means the defragmentation of the memory is going to kick off. So that's how the high-level overview of how the GC looks like, so whenever it kicks off. And bring to the safe point, that's the first step we see in the GC execution. So what this means, this is the thread life thread execution life that we are seeing, wherein in a program, if you see how multiple threads are running, in the first case is a thread 1, excuse me a second, so this is a thread 1 getting running in a normal application execution, and thread 2 is also running at a normal thread execution, and thread 3 comes into play, and that's when the allocation failed at this stage. So this is the place when the memory allocation for thread 3 failed, and then the GC is going to definitely kick off, right? And at this point, GC is going to say that, okay, bring EE, that means execution engine, to a safe point. So this is the first step in the GC. But at this point, the other threads are still running. Okay? And now once you determine that everything is safe point, that means all the other threads will be halted at this point. So this is the stop, or in other words, suspended. So all these threads will be suspended till the rest of the task for GC is going to be done. And with then the GC will collect, GC collection starts kickoff here at this interval. And at this point, it's going to do the mark, sweep, and compact. And then it's going to be done. And there, from there on, the threads will be resumed. So that's how the bring to save point is what this means is. So it's going to bring, in other words, if you as a user and what happens is the application will stop responding for quite some time. It depends upon how fast the GC collect is going to take. This is the ideal scenario for the stop the world GC. Okay, the stop the world GC is going to do the mark, sweep, and compact all together in one stitch, as we have seen just in the previous slide. In that case, it's going to application is going to be halted completely, and till the GC is done its work, and soon after the GC is done, the application will start responding again. So that's how the stop the world GC works. Of course, as you see, this is one of the biggest side effect or drawback with the GC, right? And again, little bit of a history behind GC. If at all you have an experience in working with C programs or C++ program, wherein the memory management is not automatic. So one have to actually, in the programmer itself, have to do the memory allocation and deallocation manually using the malloc and dealloc, if you know that. And the power of .NET is that all that hurdles, you don't have to do it by yourself, because you just have to concentrate on the program and the business logic, and not how to how the operating system is going to manage your memory. So introducing GC late back in when the Lisp is back then, the GC concept is introduced to eliminate the user hurdles to manage the memory by themselves. Okay, this is a big, big step actually. So GC is one of the big steps, and you don't really have to reclaim any memory. And if you take a look at my code here, it is not writing a single code to allocate a memory or deallocate a memory. In other words, in the legacy, if you look at the C or C++ program, you need to see how much memory you need and then use that malloc functions or dealloc functions to allocate the given memory. And of course, you have to backtrack and see if any unused memory is reclaimed efficiently or not. Otherwise, this is going to result in the biggest evil called the memory leaks can come into place. The memory leaks is one of the biggest evil, wherein the application performance can go down and down considerably. And of course, if you say that, so introducing GC, is that eradicated completely? That means, in other words, people might ask a question like, will a .NET program can ever get into a situation of a memory leak? Will there? And the answer to that is, again, yes, it can get into a situation where you get a memory leaks scenarios appear in .NET programs too. And how to eradicate that, and we have a couple of best practices to follow, and to understand how the memory leaks really work, that's the reason we are actually getting into the details of how GC works. if you understand how DC works, then you will understand how can, in which scenario a membrane leak can be introduced. We'll see more of that in down the line, okay? And the root enumeration, so this is the root enumeration, in other words, the root objects or the root set that we are looking at. The bar B1, so in this case, as we see, there are two objects that are created, bar 1 and bar 2 of a given class. And bar, one of the instance, we made use of it, do some work, and immediately followed by it's set to null. So in this line of code, it indicates that bar 2 becomes no more a root element, a root object. So this is gone. And bar 1 is still going to continue. So what happens here is the root enumeration is going to take care of maintaining the list of the objects in the root. So JIT, in other words, just-in-time compiler, will maintain the bookkeeping of the root objects, stack, registers, and heaps, and everything. So in our context, the root objects is very important for GC. And it is highly recommended to set to null for ASP.NET applications. So this is, again, in a scenario wherein you can avoid the memory leaks, especially. So it is, instead of leaving the whole burden on GC to determine automatically, there are cases when you can help GC to notify, okay, this object I'm not going to use it unless, so in such cases, you can actually set them to null whenever you're not using it. Again, it's specific to a cases, okay, especially in the ASP.NET applications, wherein the server GC will clean them off whenever it kicks off. So server GC can kick off at any time, and it is not deterministic. Saying in respectly in ASP.NET applications, wherein the lot of request response cycle can happen rapidly, and at a given time, whenever the memory is required, the server GC is going to kick off, and that time it's going to start doing the GC process, and which by helping the process by notifying which are the objects that you're not using anymore, and also considering that the same class can be instantiated for each and every user request response cycle, you can help the GC in reducing that burden by walking through the whole thing, by a whole object tree and making mark and sweep. Instead of that, if you can straightly assign it to null, it helps the GC to perform much better and have your GC latency time much less. Again, so when I'm making is equal to null, is it really required? No, it's not required, again. But it is kind of a best practice to do it. So when you set this to null, what it happens is that object will be, the bookkeeping is going to take care of that this object is no more a root object. What it indicates that object will be marked, will not be marked by the mark algorithm. That means it is immediately be available for sweeping. Okay, so you're actually reducing the cycles or iterations within the root objects. So that's one of the best practice, but not mandatory again. And cyclic reference is, again, we have seen in the first slide, there are two objects that are referring to one another. And in this case, what's a cyclic reference and how it can be fatal or how it can be important with respect to GC? And again, going one step back, so what is a cyclic reference? In this case, as the slide shows, object A refers to object B, and object B is actually referring back to object A. This is called a cyclic reference. Okay. In this case, as we see, the mark algorithm is going to recursively, it's going to iterate or traverse through the entire object graph, starting from the root. If at all an object is referring to one another, what happens is you can imagine, if the mark is going to start from here, it's going to reach to object B, and again, if it sees another object, that means object A reference here, and it's going to come back to object A, and again, it goes, and again, object A is referring to B, so it's going to be cyclic. It's never-ending cycle between both these objects. So this becomes recursive in nature. So to To help this mark, there's a little tweak in the algorithm to avoid such kind of cyclic references. And that tweak is to check the mark bit in the mark algorithm. So this is how the mark algorithm looks like. So we have seen the GC algorithm in the one of the slide, and we are getting one step into the mark algorithm. What it's going to do is it's going to check if the respective object is already marked or not. So this will handle the cyclic reference. Okay. So yeah, before we get into the algorithm, the reason why I walk through the cyclic reference is to make this check more meaningful in this algorithm. Okay, so now it makes sense why we need to check if the object is marked or not. And if it is not marked, and that's when the mark bit is going to come into play. And this is going to set the mark bit to true. And then recursively iterate through the respective object. You're going to check the respective object if it has any children. And if it has any children, then get all the children, which is the next level of the object, whichever it's having reference to. And then iterate through the children and do the same mark again. And if you are familiar with the recursive algorithm, and this is a typical example of a recursive algorithm wherein the respective method is called by the method itself. So we are actually going to call the mark from within the mark. So this becomes a cyclic or recursively going to call and iterate through the entire object tree. So this is as simple as that. And this is a very simple algorithm, isn't it?
Yep.
It is. And the key note here is the mark check if it is not marked. So this will eliminate the cyclic reference that we have just seen. And how the sweep algorithm looks like. So we have once one of the mark is done, the sweep is going to come into play, and it's going to take the address of the given object, and it's going to iterate through the end. This is the first object. This is the address of the first heap. This is a heap start point. In other words, it's going to start from the heap. That's what it means to say. Start from the first heap and iterate throughout the heap, scan the whole heap, and list out all the objects and check if the object is marked. So if it is marked, then it's going to free the heap. That means reclaim the memory. And if it is not marked, then unmark the bit. So that's what it's going to do. And of course, this is again going to call the next heap and then iterate through the same thing, same process again. So that's how the heap sweep algorithm looks like. It sounds very simple, right? It's the very simplest algorithm, but still there are a ton of other complexities that wherein it can get more complicated. And whatever we have seen in these two slides is the high-level basic algorithm that we're looking at. And there are a couple of scenarios or complex situations wherein this becomes more complicated, and we'll see one of that. And the third one is the compaction. So again, compaction we saw in the GC algorithm that is going to plan for compact, and when the compaction or the planning is successful and it results as a true to do the compaction, that's when the compact is going to run. And why is this done? This is done to decrease the fragmentation of the memory and increase the allocation speed. Because of the defragmented memory, it's going to take more time to allocate memory, so defragmentation will help in allocation of memory much faster, and increase the locality of reference. So locality of reference is again a very important term that will take place. As we've seen in one of the step down the line, in simple to define what is the locality of reference here. In this case, we have seen that there is a gap between these two addresses, and this is what the fragmented data we are referred to. And locality of a reference is the one that refers to the how far the respective data elements are living in the memory or allocated in the memory. So what this indicates is if they are close to each other, then it's going to be much optimal and it's going to be much faster to read and write to the memory. So that's why the compaction really helps in the locality of reference. This is called the locality of reference, in other words. information. Okay, so the locality of reference is the object sitting side by side. This is helpful to read memory faster. Memory is managed in terms of pages. So that's the reason why it is more important, which is a 4 KB, and which is of course 4096 bytes. When the objects are loaded into cache, keeping related objects side by side, the class, example, the class with the containing the relation, which is containment relations, in other words, will reduce the cache hit rate. So that's how the locality of reference is going to be helpful. Wherein the memory, when it's going to read or manage the memory, it's going to be managed in terms of a page. So in a given page, if you have an object of size, for example, 1 KB object or a 2 KB object, and if you are trying to locate one object of 2 KB in one page, and the reference, that object has a reference to another object which is sitting in another page, what happens is you need to actually load those both the pages and then access them. So which is going to be more hit rate, right? So to reduce that, if you have the object sitting in the same page, then it's going to be only, you need to actually load only that given page to fulfill the object I/O operations. So that's how the locality of reference is going to be very, very helpful to boost the performance of your application or the memory, optimal usage of the memory. This could be elaborated in detail, but I hope you understand what I mean to say. And compaction is a very, very slow process because it need to actually move the objects physically from one address to another address and also reset the references of the objects that are referring to this object. So it actually need to move physically, number one, and number two is iterate through the object which are referring to it and update their addresses so that their reference will not break. So that's why it is very expensive operation in the GC process, and that's the reason why we need a plan to GC. Hence the compaction planning is done prior hitting this. And to accommodate this, again, GC doesn't, C# don't support pointers to benefit this, because pointers is a concept wherein you can actually refer to the address of a given object which can be anywhere in your heap. And to have a maximum performance out of the GC, the pointer is going to be a big pain. And one of the reason why C# doesn't support pointers or the .NET doesn't support pointers is this, because it's going to hamper the original logic how the GC is going to work with. And again, but can you really can't write any program with pointer, without pointers or with pointers? Of course, without pointers is a element thing, but with pointers. But still, there is a way you can actually write programs in C# especially, but VB.NET you can't. It's completely ruled out. And C# you can write programs that using which you can write pointers, but that becomes an unsafe program, so you have to explicitly notify the compiler that this program is making use of your pointers, in which case you need to explicitly say it's an unsafe program. There are several reasons for that again, so we'll see more of that in detail when we in the next session probably, yeah, wherein we'll see what is implication and how the code verification is done, and during the code verification process is going to, that's a key check that's going to be done, especially if you're using any pointers or not. But still, C#, it is possible to write pointers, but in other words, it becomes an unsafe program. And run based on fragmentation. So based on the fragmentation, if it is too fragmented, that's what it means to say. It's going to run based on the fragmentation. That's what it means to say. And need to strike balance as compaction is very costly. So that's where what portion of the memory you want to compact and what portion you can skip, because the compaction process is going to be very expensive. That's need to have a strike balance between them. And elaborate language platform support required. Again, this is again specific to, since we are this is completely at the bottom line of the memory management. That can vary based on the respective platform, that means respective operating system again. So that's about the compaction. And to boost the performance of the compaction, to optimize the compaction, .NET uses generational GC. So how can we make use of this? What is a generational GC? So as per the study of the objects in a given program, so most objects die young. So things like you create an object and you're going to make use of anything that is within the scope of a method. For example, a quick example would be, I can go back to the same code example here. In this case, we have created this M, which is completely within the scope of my button click. And soon after the scope ends, this M becomes a garbage. That means it is available for reclaiming. So what its lifespan is very small. As you see, it's created inside the click and gone out of the click. So that's me. This is the most ideal scenario wherein things can happen. That's when they die young. And the cases where you declare a global level or a class level variables, those will be likely to stay for a longer life. And as a best practice, it's not recommended to have a global variables, especially if it is very large in size. And in considering this scenario here, 98% of the garbage is new. Okay, so in this way you can actually bifurcate between what are the objects that can die young and versus what are the percentage of the objects that can live for long. So to reduce the iteration time and also the compaction process, the generational GC is going to take care of that. And how it's going to work, we'll see. So in other words, this phenomena is also termed as an infant mortality or a generational hypothesis. So this is how it refers to the 98% of the garbage is new and it's going to die young. And again, if it is like a 98% in all the cases, then it's almost you're actually scanning through all the object tree. It's an ideal scenario where most of the memory is going to be young and it's going to die young. And if you target this, you can reclaim a large portion of the memory for use. And in the detail algorithms of the generational GC, it's going to segregate objects by age into multiple generations. Okay, and how many generations do we have in .NET? So we have 4 generations. People normally refer to this as the 3 generations if you have already walked through the garbage collection. But the truth is, again, this is again specific to the CLR again. In case of a compact CLR, it's going to have 4 generations. And otherwise, it normally has 3 generations. And the 4th generation is a special generation which is used for the large objects. Okay, and we'll see what is a large object means again. And the younger generation is collected often, as we see. This is the high-level synopsis of, the high-level synopsis of the GC algorithm. So the younger generation is collected often, that means the first generation or the zeroth generation, in other words. So when an object is created, it's going to put into the zeroth generation. And if it survives in the first iteration, that is your GC collect got kicked off, and if that survives, that means it has a strong reference in the first iteration, it's going to be promoted to the next generation, which is it becomes in the first generation. And again, if it survives in the first generation, then it will be promoted to the second generation. So as we know that most of the portion of the memory is young, dies young, so most of the objects is going to die here itself. So what happens here is the compaction wise, it's going to look into the younger generation more often. So every time it's going to run, it's going to look into the younger generation to collect the memory. And if at all it ran through the younger generation and it still finds the need to reclaim more memory and that's when it's going to iterate into the next generation, which is 1. And again, if it feels the need that it needs more memory, and that's when it will go into the large object heap or the long objects that are going to sustain long in the life, which is the second generation. That's the max generation that's available. And of course, there's one more heap, the fourth generation. In other words, there's another heap, one heap for these three generations, and there's a separate heap called the large object heap, you know, the large object generation. And whichever objects normally exceed the size of 85K, they will be placed directly into a large object heap, or LOG or LOH, in other words. So what happens is they won't actually pass through the 0, 1, 2 stages. They will directly go into the large object heap. So that's the reason you need to actually also consider the fact that what is the max size, what's the size of your object that you're creating inside the memory. If it is too large, that means it is exceeding 85K, again, that 85K number is specific to the compact framework, I believe, and that max size can vary based on the platform or the CLR and the language that you're using. So 85K is the standard number. And of course, some of the interviews do ask this kind of questions, and again, it becomes important to know that how the GC is going to treat the objects based on their size. So if it is less than 85K, it's going to put it in the normal generation, which is the first heap, and the second heap is dedicated only for the large objects. So if you have objects greater than 85K, then it's going to directly promote it to the large object generation, which is not going to be visited very often. Okay, as you see, first priority is 0 generation, second priority is the first generation, and the third priority is the second generation, in which case it's also look into the large object heap. Okay, so what it indicates is objects that are going to survive in the iterations are likely to stay long. That means whichever objects stay long, they are going to consume your memory for a long period of time. Okay, so they're revolving this phenomenon. There are a lot of best practices that you can do, which we will see down the line. Okay, a failure to collect or age promotes them to higher generation. So this is the scenario when you're going to get promoted. Number one scenario is a failure to collect. If the object is failed to collect the memory, when it can fail. It can fail in scenarios where you have the finalization block implemented. Okay, and we'll see that scenario also down the line. In that case, the finalization can break. In that case, the collection of the reclaiming of the memory can fail. If it fails, then it is guaranteed that that object is going to be promoted to the higher environment, higher generation. Or age promotes them to the higher. So that means if they survive in the first generation, first cycle, they're going to be promoted to the next one. The higher generation is rarely collected. So this is one of the phenomena that you need to keep in mind. So that's why keeping your objects longer in your program is going to be very harmful, because you always advise to create the variables in appropriate places or wherein it can be reclaimed quickly as possible. If at all there is a need, definitely you can make them available for a longer life in the memory. And this generational GC is used by multiple other languages, including ML, Lisp, Haskell, and SmartTalk. These are again object-oriented programming languages. And similarly, .NET and some other implementations use the generational GC, as I stated in the beginning. So this is one of the type of GC, which is not specific to .NET, but .NET adopted this for implementing the GC. Okay, and incremental collection. So this is again scenario, one of the scenario that we are talking about, wherein the algorithm can go more complex. In this scenario, when it's specific to the generational GC, we'll try to walk through what can happen here. In the first case, you have the this is the first generation we're talking about, zero generation, in other words. So this is the zero generation we are in. So this part is a zero generation and this part is a generation one. Okay, so that's how it's classified too. And in this case, the first root here is available, which is marked, which that means it is traversed through, and the second one is again is available at the first GC run. The third one is marked to null. Okay, in other words, so when it in the first case it is reachable, that means it is blue and it's going to reachable to the respective object, and wherever you see the tick marks, that means it's reachable, that means it has a strong reference. And in the second case, wherever in this case the root object itself is set to null, which indicates that this whole object tree can be reclaimed in the gen 0. So all these objects are inside this gen 0. That's a key thing to remember in this example. That means all these objects are not marked to be visited, and that means they are ready for reclaiming by the sweep algorithm. But in this case, there's another one which is actually referring to the objects inside gen 1. Okay, this is a higher object group. But in the gen 1, because this is not visited every time, what happens here is that there could be an object, like in this case, that is referring to an object in the gen 0 in this case. In this case, this is the object that you are referring to. What happens in this case is because this is marked as marked for allocation, because the original logic we have seen that it starts from the root and it refers to the element there and then it's rooting out, and some part of the code is actually you have a higher generation object which is marked a reference to that object now. And in this case, what happens ideally in the standard scenario, a mark will run, it's going to see that these are all not marked, and sweep is going to kick off. It will see that there is no mark bit assigned to this, so it's going to start reclaiming it. And now no one has actually taken into account that there's another object inside a different generation referring to this. So we're using our basic algorithm, it doesn't satisfy this scenario. Okay, so this is in other words called an incremental collection, wherein gen 0 in higher generation is referring to a lower generation. Okay, so this is ideal scenario. So to mitigate this issue, there's something called the cart table. What happens is this cart table is going to track the scenario of objects from higher generation referring to the objects inside a lower generation. So in addition to the root objects that we are traversing through, it also takes an account of the cart table. In cases, the cart table is going to contain the list of objects that are referred by an objects from a different generation, that means a higher generation. So this indicates that these objects should not be reclaimed. So another check added up to the sweep algorithm is to check, first thing is going to check if it is there is no mark bit assigned, and the second check is going to see if this object is not a member of the cart table. So if it is not a member of cart table, then this, that means this is not referred by anyone else, you're going to, it's good to reclaim. So that's how it's going to go. Okay, so this is the introduction to the cart table in context with the generational garbage collection. Good. And the finalization, this is one of the bad guys, and why it's bad guy, we'll see. And how can you, what is the finalization block in, if you're familiar with the constructors and destructors in the previous languages, the finalization block is nothing but the destructor. And if you go back to our example, how can we make, how can we create a constructor and destructor? Again, don't worry, we have a complete a detailed session on the constructors and destructors and types of constructors we have. Specific to this session, we'll be looking into the destructor side. And to create a constructor for this, right now it doesn't have a constructor. But of course, if you go back to the object heap, If I take a look at my math here, it doesn't have a constructor by default, but there is a default constructor which is actually comes out of the object itself. So this is the default constructor available by default. So in .NET, that's the fundamentally default constructor is created by default, and which is what we're actually making reference here. So this open and close, this refers to the default constructor, okay, so which is implicitly defined for you without your notice. Okay, we don't worry about the default. We can always write a default constructor by using this. So this is how the constructor looks like. And in our example, we are more want to get into the destructor side. So this is the destructor implementation for my class. Okay, and what is wrong with this method? Okay, why it is enabled? Okay, we'll see that. So in other words, the destructor is a place is going to be visited when the object is going to be reclaimed by the garbage collector. And to just a quick demo on this, I'm going to just say that you know we are in constructor, and I'll say finalizer. Okay, in other words, call it destructor if you look at it in other terms. And I'm going to add a breakpoints here just to see when these are visited. Okay, I'm going to hit this button, and soon after I hit the button, that means when this code is visited, that's when the constructor is going to be visited. Okay, and I'm going to hit run again. So it's running fine, the application is still fine, it's not going to be visited. So in this case, it's a very simple scenario wherein I'm actually going to kill the application. So that's when the finalizer is going to be visited immediately. So this is one case where the GC again kicks off and cleans up the memory, and when it sees it, there's a finalizer implementation for the given block, it's going to call it. And whichever you want to, like the manual cleanup of your memory allocation, if you want to do here, you can do it. Again, what is the drawback with this? Why it is called enable? We'll see. Because there's a lot of algorithms behind how the finalization block is executed, that's when it becomes enable. Once we see how the internal algorithm really works in handling the finalization block, we will have more understanding about this. To understand this, the first thing is the finalization active list. So it's going to actually, whenever the instantiation of the given class is instantiated in the memory, it's going to check if there is a finalization block implemented for the given block. And if at all it sees that there is a finalizer implemented for this class, then it's going to add them into the finalization active list. Okay, so that's the first step going to start when the object is going to be created, especially implement the finalization block, okay? And when the first run of the GC happens and it sees, Okay, so when it first GC run going to happen, it's going to traverse through the objects. In this case, this is the visited one, which is marked, and this is the object that is not visited and ready for claiming. And it's going to see that there is a finalization block implemented because it's part of the finalization active list. So when GC runs and the object with finalizer is marked for sweep, the sweep will check for the reference in FAL. So FAL is actually populated when the object is created. And whenever it sees this object is a member of the finalization active list, it's going to do nothing but move the object into the finalization ready list. So this is during the first GC run. Okay, so it's not going to reclaim it because there is a finalization block that need to be fired before it can be reclaimed. Because what it means is whenever there is a finalization block implemented, what it indicates to the runtime is that I have a special code that I want to run before you claim the memory for this class, or for the object of this class. That means this M, wherever is it? Okay, this is M. So whenever you're going to reclaim this, please call my finalization block, because I have a special cleanup code that I have written for this specific class. So that's what it indicates. That means that message is interpreted by the runtime, that is a sweep algorithm, is to check if it is part of the finalization active list, then okay, you're going to be treated specially, be in the other list which is going to be visited by someone else. So it's going to just move it from FAL to FRL, which is finalization ready list. That means one TC run passed, but this object is still alive in the memory. And in other words, we have seen that there's a weak reference. There are two types of weak references. One is a short, another one is a long. And in this case, this is the long weak reference. That means this weak reference, although it is a weak reference, it's going to be there in the memory for a long time, because it survives the first GC run. And again, so this is the case where this is moved to the finalization ready list. And soon after the GC run is done, the finalizer thread is kicked off. So after the GC run is done, at this point, we have seen that all the objects which are having the finalizer block and ready to reclaim, they are sitting inside the finalization ready list. And now the GC run is done, and finalizer thread is another key thing. It's going to kick off. And what this finalizer thread is going to do is, soon after the GC, it's going to run and look up into the finalization ready list and call the finalizer of the respective objects that are inside this list. So at this point, things can go weird. What happens is, first thing is, the finalization is completely out of your scope, because you never know when this finalizer is going to run. In the demo that we have just seen, it is a scenario where I have terminated the application, and that's when the GC actually came to clean up the and it visited the finalizer block. But if the application is running and it's live, and the scenario reached that you need to collect the memory, at that point it's actually going to do at the runtime, right? So when it's going to do at the runtime, scenario is going to be completely different, because you cannot determine when it's going to kick off, when it's going to be reclaimed. So that's number one. And number two is, if at all your finalization block, in this case, you have written some statement that can fail. It's quite obvious that whenever you write your own code, it can fail, it can have errors. And when that happens, what happens is the respective thread is going to be failed. If one of the finalization block in the object throws an exception, then this thread is going to be aborted completely, and it leaves the rest of the objects into jeopardy. So it's going to, all the other objects will again be left over without calling the finalization block, and those objects again survives the next generation, which is next GC run. So that's why if you have finalization block, those are the problems you're going to see. Either it's first thing is, it's not guaranteed that this function or this finalization block can be executed guaranteed. Execution is not guaranteed, number one. And also, if it fails in general, because of one of the other objects finalization block, it's going to fail the entire finalization thread, and that's when it's not guaranteed. And also, it's not deterministic when it's going to be called. Okay? Those are the two major reasons when it becomes an evil. Hence it's not recommended to have a finalization block. But of course, there are scenarios when you might want to do it by yourself. But again, to accommodate that, we have some of the best practices. We'll see all of that again. And this is when the GC run 2 kicks off, and the references, now in this case, it's going to see that this has a weak reference. That means there's no more referred and it's available to reclaim. And also it sees that it's not part of the finalization active list, and now it's good to claim. Okay, in this case, what happens is, if you take a scenario where it's in the finalization ready list, and the finalization thread actually failed one of the method, and some of the methods are not called, some of the finalization blocks are not called because of the fail in the thread itself, or thread got aborted, right? And in that scenario, what happens is the GC2 runs, it's going to see that it's not in the part of the finalization active list, and it's going to reclaim. In that scenario, what happens is whatever code you have written for the finalization block is never executed. That's when it cannot guarantee that the finalization block can ever be executed for sure. Okay, that's the one of the big drawback. And thus, objects with finalization finalizer is guaranteed that they will get promoted. This is another scenario wherein it will be guaranteed to promote the higher generation. That's another drawback. We have talked about three disadvantages, ma'am. And finalizer is not guaranteed to run. That's what we have been discussing just now. And that's because of if the finalization block breaks in any one of the object, then it's going to break the whole thread. But again, scenarios, you might come into scenarios wherein you want to have a finalization block. Okay, in scenarios like, for example, you are doing any file I/O operations, file I/Os, especially for the global level, application level file I/O operations, or a kind of a long-lasting connections to other COM components, in other words, which are again globally used in your application, which you want to close the handles, again, especially with the COM objects, which is unmanaged code, which is running on a different process area, you want to bring them down as well because they are completely unmanaged. In those scenarios, you want to write a cleanup code especially. But you still have to handle such scenarios efficiently. So there are ways to handle such scenarios efficiently, especially when you're dealing with the COM references and you want to bring down the COM as well. Along with the application, then you have to write a robust code to make sure that it's not going to break both the places. To do that, to ensure that finalizer is called efficiently, you need to actually do one small thing, and that is implementing the critical finalizer object. So if you make sure that you notify the runtime, especially the GC, to that this object has a critical finalizer and this must be executed at all times, then the CLR, the GC can take that into account and make sure that the finalizer is called, and the call of the finalization is guaranteed, in other words. And how can I do that again? Again, I don't know where this critical finalizer is really in the object tree. So again, I'll go back to my object browser and I'll look for critical. Okay, this is a critical finalizer I'm looking for, and I see that it's part of the system.runtime.constraint.execution. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get this namespace, copy. So I'm just showing the approach in which we can go through, because in this slide, if I see that, I know that there is a critical finalizer object that I need to implement to ensure that my finalization block must be executed at all times. And now I'm back to the program, and I'm going to say using, okay, and I have to inherit from critical. In other words, let me see this. Oops, I'm putting in the wrong place, that's why it's cribbing. I should be inheriting from the class critical finalizer block. So this is what it takes. Once you inherit from this or implement this, you're good to go. So it's always guaranteed that this finalizer is going to be visited. In general, if I run this code, it's going to run just normal, just the way it used to be. Except that we have passed a hint to the runtime that this class is having a critical finalizer and must be guaranteed to execute. And instead of doing this route, there is a much more efficient way, which is called implementing a dispose pattern. If you use a dispose pattern, the cleanup of memory is going to be completely within your control. That means because the destructor or the finalizer block is not calling this block is not deterministic. When this is going to be called, we don't know in the whole application lifecycle. So if you want to make sure that once we are done using a given COM component or a given external resource that we are using in, we want to close the resource and get rid of it to make use of the optimal memory allocation or usage of it. To do that, you can do an iDisposable pattern implementation. Using that, you can write your own iDisposable pattern and call the dispose method whenever you think you need to dispose that memory off. Okay, so that's the best way to write instead of doing a finalization block and also going through the critical finalizer block. And the .NET DC implementation has a 4 generation in 2 heaps, and the first Gen 0, Gen 1, Gen 2, and a special large object generation that we have just discussed, and auto tuning budgets. Again, each of these can be having an allocation limits again, and user segments to have these generations managed, and the large object, which is greater than 85k, and large object heap can be used, and there is no compaction and no compaction for the large object heap, and connected along with the Gen 2, as we have discussed about this. This is how the .NET GC implementation goes with. And GC has multiple GCs again. You have multiple types of GCs. One is a workstation GC, in other words, a unit processor, and also multiprocessor unit GCs are available for server GCs, in other words, especially for servers. GC running on the server is completely different from the GC that's running on the client, because the way things are handled, like especially the unit processor or the multiprocessor, the GC runs in a different way. So there are multiple versions of GCs too. And best practices for GC and what to avoid. Object pools is used. Again, object pools as a background, if at all you are familiar with the C++ programming. In object pool, as I've been referring to, where you create the memory pool for a given set of objects well ahead before they get used. And you can still, of course, try to do that in C#, especially, but with .NET you can't do that. Which is one of the best way people used to do earlier, and that's no more a best practice in .NET. When it comes to .NET, don't try to go with the object pools, because if at all you try to manage the memory allocation or deallocation by yourself, all the optimization logics, the algorithms that we have seen so far with the GC, all of that will be of no use. What will happen in return is that the objects can get promoted to the higher generations, and they are likely to stay for a more longer period than what you have imagined. So in general, avoid object pools. And you may also call the GC explicitly by just saying gc.collect. Just me in this, if I can say gc.collect. So this is how you can actually, in other words, you can access the GC directly from your code. And if you take a look at the various methods available, and GC itself is again a static class, and it has a lot of methods available, and you can see the max generations properties gets the, again, this is the max generation that's supported by my current system. And that's all you can get into this class and actively have the respective total memory in a given. You can actually iterate through the whole memory that your program is actually using. And also, one of the most useful one is the collect. Using this, you can actually, it has two overloads. Oops, sorry. One is by default, it's going to collect the whole GCs. In other words, you can also pass the, I want to keep this live. And yep, oops, it's course. Okay, I'm fine to retain that, but of course, in other words, we can also go to the object browser to see the text what we have there. I can simply say gc. This is system.gc. It has all these methods available, and within the collect, where is the collect? So this is the collect, and collect has another overload. This is the forces the immediate garbage collection for all generations. That's what the default is. And also you can actually pass the generation as a parameter to it, wherein you can specify forces an automatic garbage collection for generation 0 through a specified generation. Okay, so that's all about this, and the gc.collect, as I mentioned, this is a static class. So that means you don't have to actually create instance of it. You can actually directly call the members of the GC class directly, as we have been doing here. So you can do this explicitly. Although you can do this, it's not recommended to do. Why? Because if you start doing this, what happens is if you go back to the scenarios when the GC comes into play, so whenever the memory, so in other words, whenever you need is going to be called, right? So you call this explicitly for every scenario that you have in your application. That means you're more likely to call GC more times. What happens every time it's going to run is it's going to promote the other objects in the that are more likely not to stay for so long, but you explicitly make them to survive with the higher generation. So what happens is the optimization that we have, the whole purpose of having generational GC is to optimize the compaction, right? And that you're going to lose once you start collecting GC very often. So it's not recommended to have a call this gc.collect by yourself. But of course, if at all there is a very valid reason to do it, it's available to do it, and it's going to work for you, but it need to be handled very cautiously. Okay, otherwise you will end up promoting younger objects to live in a higher generation, which are not going to be claimed so often. So that means the unwanted memory is going to be still be occupied by the objects. So unwanted objects is going to be still there in the memory for a longer periods. That's what it meant to say. Okay, so and another evil here is the boxing. So whenever a value type is converted to a reference type during which a heap allocation happens. So again, what is boxing, what is unboxing, what is this heap, and what is the stack, all that we have a detailed session down the line in which I'm going to cover. So right now, if you don't know what is a boxing and what you don't understand that the statement saying a value type is converted to a reference type, what does it mean? Don't worry about that. We'll cover that in a detailed session later on. But again, in general, at this point, boxing is again one of the sidekicks which need to be avoided at all times, which can lead in creating more garbage because you are actually having objects created inside the heap for unwanted reasons. Okay, and structures implementing interfaces. This is the ideal scenario. Again, you don't know what is the structure at this point and what is the interface at this point, so don't worry about it. So whenever you have structures which are of value type, implementing interfaces, which is possible with structures, in that case, what happens implicitly, it's going to be boxing happens, because whenever you implement interfaces, the structures will no longer be inside a stack. It's going to be promoted to heap, and that's what implicitly a boxing scenario happens, which is again not recommended. Good. And the finalization, and what are the best practices with the finalization? Okay, use a dispose pattern wherever you want to do it. I mean, avoid the finalization block at all times because of the reasons we have seen. And don't rely only on the finalization, okay? Because finalization is not guaranteed and not deterministic. And because it's not guaranteed, that's what it says. Finalizer has to be thread safe. Again, another important aspect, because the finalizer, whenever you implement, if and all this object is going to be used in multiple threads, it must be a thread safe. So do not use the TLS. And order or even serial execution is not guaranteed. So a lot of disadvantages in more than that we have discussed so far, and needs at least 2 GC runs to reclaim and the results in and results in promotion. That means it's going to promote the objects to higher generation, and also it requires 2 GC runs. And do not use other managed objects, and do not throw, crash, hang the finalizer. So don't use exception handling to throw an exception inside a finalizer block, which is going to be failing the whole finalizer thread, finalization thread. And release references you do not need for finalization. Okay, so those are some of the best practices when it comes to the finalization block. And pinning is another evil when we play with .NET especially, because pinning is one of the basic thing that people will do to notify the compaction not to move the given object from the current address. So as you see that as part of the compaction, the core thing it does is it's going to try to reallocate or rearrange the object so that the locality of reference is bare minimal. In that action, the objects that are sitting in a given memory address can move from a given address to a different address. And what happens if you are actually referring to that address in your program, especially by using pointers? And this becomes vital, especially whenever you're playing with the COM-based components in your .NET projects. So in that case, you want to let the compaction know that you don't want this specific object to be moved from its original address, because we have a hard reference to this address in our program. That scenario is called pinning. So you can pin a given reference whenever you create an object, but it's always advised to unpin it soon after you're done using it, because if you end up having a lot of pins or objects with so many pins, and at the end the compaction will go for a toss, because compaction, although it's going to run, it cannot move them because of the pinning. So that's the reason. Use pinning deliberately. So wherever it is used, unpin it soon after you're done. Okay, so that's what again. And be careful with the large objects, especially with 85k bytes, otherwise 85k. And pinning is bad for GC performance. Set references to null as soon as you can, especially before blocking. Yes, this is one other thing we have discussed. If you explicitly set to null, this indicates that this object can be taken off from the root enumeration, or in other words, root set, so that you can actually help the GC perform much better. But again, doing that, what it means that you're actually handling the memory management by yourself. And again, is it required or not? If you ask the question, it is recommended, but it's not required. Although if you don't set it to null, eventually it's going to be reclaimed anyway. But if you do that, it's good, especially when you have a multi-threaded applications, or especially server-based application like an ASP.NET application that we are talking about, wherein you can create multiple objects for every request and response cycle. And use weak references for caching. And weak references we did talk about. Wherever you need a weak reference, you can use it for caching. And caching, in other terms, you can maintain the same objects inside a cache, which can be accessed whenever it is required and within a dedicated memory. And instead of that, weak references, again, you can make use of it wherever you can. And again, you can also choose the respective GC, whether, again, as I mentioned, GC, it's of two types. Again, you have a server GC or a client GC. And especially with the ASP.NET applications, you can choose which type of GC you want to go with. And this is the typical configuration for a application, wherein under the runtime, you have a GC concurrent and a GC server. You can actually enable them by using true or false. Using this, you can choose which GC you want to implement in your program. Okay. And type of GC operations. As we discussed, top of the world is one of the GC operation wherein it will completely bring your application to a halt and do the mark sweep and compact, and then resume the execution. At this point, you'll see the delay in the response time for the application whenever the GC comes into play, because why it is required to bring the application to a halt stage, because if you take a look at the compaction, it's going to actually physically move the objects from one address to another address, and whichever is referring to that address, it's going to update them back to the new address. So during that process, you have to make sure that none of other parts of the code or program is referring to the address, because the address isn't changing right now. In that case, it is important that it need to bring the whole application, or at least the respective threads which are making use of it, to a halt and do the compaction. That's the reason. It need to bring the application to a halt stage, and that cannot be avoided in any case anyway. But how you tailor that approach makes different GC operation modes. In this case, stop the world GC is going to stop the whole application to bring to a standstill and do the compaction and then resume it. So this is a one-step process, which is going to be much faster, one-shot GC process, but it can give you a slight delay or the latency of the respective application to perform, which is not acceptable in many scenarios. If you're working with a program and it stops responding for a couple of seconds, or sometimes if it goes for minutes is not a case we are looking at, but it might not respond to your actions for a couple of milliseconds or seconds. In that case, you definitely feel not comfortable in using that program. So it's again not a recommended or not an acceptable solution. And incremental GC, to mitigate those problems, we have another GC mode called the incremental GC, wherein the respective phases of the GC cycle, which is the mark or sweep and compaction, run in a different discrete phases, wherein the user will not see, in other words, the latency of these processes is distributed across multiple phases of the project, so that the user won't see, visually don't feel that there is a latency happening inside with respect to, in contrast to the stop the world GC. So incremental GC is going to break those each and every tasks into different increments. Okay, and that's how it's going to take more time to do the entire GC process, because it's not going to run in one single stretch. Okay, and another one is a background GC, which is an enhanced GC in which the GC thread need not lock the heap. In other words, whenever it's going to do the compaction with the heap, the heap is going to be locked because, as I mentioned, none of the other program need to be referring to it, because the addresses are going to change during compaction. When its background GC comes into play, it will not lock the heap as a whole. It removes the extra pauses caused in the concurrent GC. The extra pauses are because of the locking of the heap, and only remain the limited pauses when the young generations are collected, a foreground collection, in other words. So background GC is again much more efficient down the line. The latency with the user experience is going to be much, much reduced by using a background GC, wherein it's not going to lock the heap as a whole, but it's going to definitely lock the respective areas wherever it needs to. So definitely it has to lock it whenever the address is in move. That's inevitable again. So when you're going to do it is a question, whether you wanted to do with a, just like a stop the world GC, it's going to lock the whole heap, so the whole program can go for a halt. In background GC, what happens is it's going to lock the heap only when an object need to be moved from a current location to your new location. Otherwise, it's not going to lock it. In other words, in contrast to the earlier case, when the soon after the compact kicks off, if you lock it, and where you might move 100 objects out of 1,000 objects, in which case the rest of the 900 objects are not available for use. In background GC, it's not that case. So it's going to lock only when it's an object is in move. Otherwise, rest of the heap is still available for use by the application. But that means your use and update is still, your I/O is still going to be operational. In which case, the latency is going to be bare minimal, and that's how the background GC is going to be doing. And concurrent GC is the most recent one, and it is a generational, and it did not stop program execution at all, almost. Again, it's almost, but again, there are cases where it has to do it, and which is almost negligible. And concurrent GC, it uses the stop the world strategy again, for only a limited part of the heap again, like a given generation again. For generation 0 and then generation 1 is going to do the stop the world GC, but not a whole inset, a whole together. And the rest of the heap is allocated with a dedicated GC thread, which can run concurrently with the applicative threads again. So that's how the concurrent GC is going to be more responsive than the background GC again. So in the recent time, while the types of GCs that are available in the .NET, the .NET framework uses the generational GC in general, and the table shows below, it shows the operations mode supported in each CLR version. And the framework version and CLR version, as you see, they all go side by side, and the CLR version is much stable framework 2.0, version 2.0 with respect to the, it started from the framework 2.0 version, and the CLR version did not undergo any changes until the recent time, which is 4.0, okay, wherein the background GC is introduced in 4.0. This is again specific to, as we know, specific to the parallel programming. In the parallel programming helps in writing programs that targets the multi-core processors, as we have discussed in the previous sessions, and that's the reason the CLR also underwent changes to support that kind of programs, and to again boost the GC algorithm, the background GC is introduced. Otherwise, so far the previous ones has a concurrent GC in place, and of course it's generational. In other case, it's a generational GC, but this is the type of GC, in other words, the mode in which they operate is the concurrent or background. And of course, Visual Studio version in which this is available is 2010, and of course default in Windows. Right now it's not available as part of anything, so Windows 8 is going to come with default framework version to 4.0. So that's the overview of the GC and the operation mode it runs in. And this is the last part of the session, and this is the chart that shows the background GC performance versus the concurrent GC. And as you see, the concurrent GC, the spikes that you see in the concurrent GC versus the spikes the GC, the background GC, the background GC is much more efficient than the concurrent GC we see. And this is supported in the framework 4.0, and this has been there for quite some time so far. Okay, so this is about the performance testing. In other words, this is the profiling of the sample latency duration application. In other words, you don't want to really care about it, and all these timelines we see on the left hand side is the time in microseconds. And of course, it's not that visible, but it's going to be efficient enough to handle. And background GC, because it's going to run very optimally the way we have discussed, its spikes are much lesser, and it's evenly distributed throughout the application. And it's more efficient. This is again especially useful for the .NET 4.0, where the parallel programming is a new feature. Okay, so we have just walked through the internals of the garbage collection, and we did see an overview, and we did have introduction to John McCarthy, the man behind the garbage collection back in Lisp programming. And we did see the terminologies about the object reference graph. We did see what is a root object and what is the blue ones and red ones, which is the unreachable objects versus the reachable ones. And we did see all those strong references and the weak references and the active references, in other words. And we did see the various different algorithms used in garbage collections across industry, the tricolor marking, mark and sweep collection, mark and don't sweep, copying garbage collection, mark, sweep, compact garbage collection, which is very commonly used in .NET especially. And also mark and sweep is also used in .NET based on various different types of GCs that we have in .NET. And we did also see the generational garbage collection, what it stands for, .NET also deploy this generational garbage collection algorithm. And stop the world garbage collection, this is also used in .NET, and incremental garbage collection, another algorithm, and there's a concurrent garbage collection. This is also there in the .NET world. So most of these algorithms are used in .NET in general. And we did a deep dive into what is a mark and sweep algorithm, what is a mark algorithm looks like, a sweep algorithm looks like, and what's a compact algorithm does. All these we did a deep dive, and we did walk through what is a strong reference in detail and the weak reference, and also the short weak reference and the long weak reference too. And we did see what is a mark bit in detail, and also we did see the detailed step-by-step action of the mark and sweep algorithm, how the objects are marked and sweeped using that, and how the compaction will help in defragmenting the memory area. And also we did see the GC execution and when it is going to kick off and when it is going to and how. And we did see how the GC execution brings to a safe point before it does the compaction in general. And we did see the root enumeration with a very good example here. And also we did see the cyclic references between the objects and how this is mitigated within the mark algorithm. And we did see this cyclic reference, how it is handled with a simple code block here. We did see the sweep algorithm, how it looks like and how it's, what are the different steps it's going to walk through. And also we did see the compaction, what is a locality of reference, what is a compaction. A compaction is a very slow process, and what are the best practices around that. We did walk through all of that. And we did see what is the generational garbage collection and what is the infant mortality in general refers to when it comes to the garbage collection. And also we did see the detailed algorithms about generational GC, and also we did see the incremental collection. In incremental collection, we have a cart table especially, wherein the references of the objects from the higher generation to the lower generation, how it is tracked using the cart table, and how this incremental collection is handled. We did see the finalization blocks. So if a class implements a finalization block, how it can be, what are the significant impact with respect to the garbage collection it's going to introduce. We did walk through in detail, starting from the finalization active list, what it is, and also we did see the finalization ready list, and once a thread is run, it's going to clean off, and in the second run only, the memory is going to reclaim in the second run. So it guarantees that be in the memory for two runs. Okay, and we did see all the .NET garbage collection implementations with four different generations in two heaps, Gen 0, 1, 2, and a special large object generation for objects greater than 85K. So .NET has multiple flavors of GCs in general for UP machines and MP machines, which is unit processor and multiprocessors. So workstation GC with the server GCs, the different general flavors you have, and also for the compact .NET framework for especially for the Windows phones, mobile devices, tablet devices, it has a compact GC as well. So based on the platform, you have different types of GCs available. And we did see what are the best practices and what to avoid, especially the object pools and GC.collect explicit invocation of that and the boxing. And the structures implementing interfaces, what is the impact with that? So there is an implication of a boxing happening if you implement interfaces inside structures. And finally, we did also see the finalization block, how to avoid it, and what are the other alternatives, such as the dispose pattern. And best practices, well, pinning. So pinning is another very old a fashion way of pinning a memory area, and what is the impact of doing a pinning in your program, and soon after you're done with the pinning, make sure that you unpin it. Okay, so, and we did see the settings in GC in the operation mode. In web.config or app.config, you can specify the runtime settings under configuration. With the GC concurrent GC enabled, false or true, or a GC a server GC enabled, true or false within the application. And the type of GC operation modes we did see, stop the world GC, what it stands for, incremental GC, and the background GC, and the concurrent GC. And we did see the various types of GC supported across various framework versions, and also mapped to the Visual Studio. So this grid does explain that the background GC is available in 4.0, whereas so far we have a concurrent GC, and the reason for having a 4.0 background GC is to support the parallel task library and parallel link query executions. And this is the last thing that we have walked through, which is a background GC versus concurrent GC, we see the background GC is more efficient than the concurrent GC. Okay, so hope that is good for now, and we'll continue with our next session.